Okay, guys, so welcome back to COMP 3351 2, user experience. First thing to say today is, somebody created a nice app. I remember that face from Twitter. Somebody created a nice little tool to tell people when the website gets upgraded. So, what's your name?
Matt.
So, Matt created this nice little tool. And as part of that, I realised that we've got this hashtag up here, COMP 3351 2. Can you tweet it to COMP 3351 2?
Yeah.
Okay. Also, you're all free to tweet to this hashtag. Okay. So you can go on the website, you can tweet it all you like. I don't care. Whatever. It's all open and free. Okay. So it's, so if you want to communicate with me, or you want to communicate with each other about anything you like, the website was down a few weeks ago, and I want to tweet about that. That's fine. Okay. That way, at least, you'll know what's going on, okay? So we're kind of crowdsourcing it, yeah? Okay, so please do tweet it, and also when the website gets updated, then that's also useful if you have to go. You have to join the sort of...
Yeah, you join that website and then you just add that, put the link in it, or just create it for you. You type in your email address.
Oh, right, okay, so that's very good. So you want an email, it does it every 15 minutes, doesn't it? Something like that. It looks at the website every 15 minutes and decides that there's been an update which has occurred. Okay, so it just means that you can be completely on the ball. Okay, so we've seen over the last few weeks what user experience is, what the landscape of user experience has been, how we've got there. We haven't done any development yet, and an update for the Agile development part is that ThoughtWorks now are coming on the 17th of April. Okay, so ThoughtWorks will be on the 17th of April, and then the week after that there'll be another company called Nemensa who are going to be coming to give you a talk on what user experience is like for UX and design companies. And we've got the BBC before the week before the Easter vacation. Okay, so the BBC are coming in to talk to us for the Easter vacation. Okay, so we've seen how all that works, and last week we saw that it's complicated. The way that people work, the way that they are, it's just really very complicated to understand. Okay, so you can't kind of rely on just one particular type of investigation or one particular type of tool. So this week we're going to look at how do we understand what the user requirements are, and then how do we communicate and model those user requirements, how do we communicate those user requirements to other people. Okay, two software engineers specifically. That's the plan. Now, pop quiz. Okay, so this is relied on you reading some of your notes. I do hope. So, what's the key focus of HCI? As per normal, I'd like some feedback. Otherwise, I'm just going to start randomly picking random people. Okay. Glad to see you all struggled through the snow this morning, but you know, I'm still going to make you work for it. Okay, so yes, first one.
I'm going to say it's the most sort of performance related metrics with the user and tracking lists.
Right, so that's right. Key focus of HCI was originally this quantitative stuff, this performance metrics, task completion time, that kind of thing. Okay, as we know. Good. What's the purpose of the UX specialist? What is the purpose of the user experience specialist? Yes?
To make sure that the user is involved at the start and throughout the process.
That's right, to make sure the user is involved at the start of the process and throughout the process. Anything else? To make sure
the interface at the end that will fit the user.
To make sure that's good, to make sure the interface that you get at the end fits the user. Anything else? So it's also to make sure that the user needs are communicated to the software engineers. They're like a translation engine, if you like, between users and an understanding of the users and the software engineers and an understanding of what the software engineers need. Okay. What's the user experience and how is it applied? Okay, so this is a little bit wordy, this is a bit long. I'm not going to go into this here, but you need to know this. Okay, it's part of one of your self-assessment questions in your coursework. So what's the user experience and how is it applied? There are no 100% correct answers. So how in user experience do we decide what's right and what's wrong? Being that it's empirical, it's an empirical science. What technique is it that we use to apply?
Statistical analysis.
Statistical analysis, very good, yes. So statistical analysis is the way you kind of find out if it's close enough. Okay. So there's no 100% correct answer, it's not like mathematics say, but it, we use statistics to understand whether we've got some level of correlation or causation. Yeah? Okay, five key properties of user experience. Now these are in notes. Okay. So who wants to mention one of these key properties of user experience? Yes?
It's only going to be utility.
Utility, excellent. Utility is the first one. Okay? So it's got to, there's got to be some utility in what you're actually building. It's not, if there's no utility in it, then there's no point in doing it. Okay, next one. Any more? Does it have to be in order? Can be in any random order you like. Yes?
Usability.
Usability, but what am I calling it? Efficiency. Okay? Anything else? Next one. That's two, we've got three more. No? Yes.
Effectiveness.
Effectiveness, which is a bit accessibility-ish. Yep.
Effectiveness.
Affectiveness.
Effectiveness.
Yes, effectiveness. So emotions. Does it give us an emotional response? Okay, and what's this? What's the final one? And this is kind of a one that I've changed the name of multiple times because I'm trying to convey something and it's difficult to do. So what do I call it in the notes? Yeah, digital dynamic umami. Okay, some kind of taste. Okay, that other sense. It's kind of a intangibleness of we like it, but we don't know why. Okay? So it's this digital umami idea. We'll get to that as well. An input modality. So we've got lots of different kinds of inputs. Pick one that's not completely easy. Input modality. Give me one input modality. So we're in a computer, we give an input to it. Give me one.
Speech.
Speech, good, yeah. Speech recognition. Any others? How many did we discuss last week?
Yeah, eye sensor.
Yeah, eye sensor, so you can gaze detection, yeah.
Gesture recognition.
Gesture recognition, good, yeah. Another one. What kind of specialist ones did we discuss last week?
On the head.
Head operated mouse, yeah, the HOM. Any others? Yeah.
Blink clicking.
Blink clicking. So how does blink clicking work?
Because a fake blink is slightly longer than a natural blink.
Yes, so a voluntary blink, it's not fake, it is blink. Okay, good. Okay, so the four main sensory channels. I'm not going to ask you to briefly explain them, but you know, it's kind of straightforward, but still tell me. What the four main sensory channels for a human? What's the channel, sensory input channel that we most use as humans, yes?
Sight.
Sight. Okay? What else we got?
Smell.
Smell? And the smell goes together with what? Taste. Okay? So it's part of the olfactory stuff. Yeah. Okay, what else we got?
Hearing.
Okay.
Touch.
Very good. So, on the smell, I mentioned it last week. Who, smell-wise, who did some interesting work on smell computing? You were listening,
wasn't
it? Some guy in Glasgow. That is one. Yes, some guy in Glasgow. Stephen Brewster. Stephen Brewster in Glasgow did some interesting work on smell computing, so that's something to look at. Okay, so the title of this lecture is called Cataracts for Understanding. And that's really what I'm trying to get across. That what we're trying to do, there's no right or wrong way directly of doing this. There's no specific kinds of techniques that you'll be right to use or you'll be wrong to use. There's a whole buffet of techniques, and you need to be able to pick out the kind of techniques that you want for specific situations and scenarios. So I'm not just going to teach you, well, you do this, then you do this, then you do this. There's no way that's ever going to work. You've got to decide, using your specialist experience when you get into the workplace, what is most useful, what is most important, and what kind of techniques will actually work best in that particular situation. Okay, so Mark Brettig says that I'll sit down and work on an assignment, start sketching screens or composing an outline, then suddenly stop and say to myself, these are all hows, but what is the what? So as software engineers, the things we often sketch, the things we get to in our heads, are mostly how we're going to do it, because that's how we think. How are we going to solve this problem? We're all problem solvers, we do computational thinking, a lot of it's how are we going to solve the problem. It's not what actually is really it that's required. Okay? Okay. What I'm really trying to deliver? What is it I'm really trying to deliver? There is an implicit what underlying most software project understandings. Okay? So what is it that's trying to get across there? And this is your job. Your job is to intervene in the software engineer's mindset, if you like, and to tell them what it is they're supposed to be doing, because they'll be well versed in how they're going to do it. Okay? They'll be thinking about how they're going to do it, and all of the screens that they'll be visualising in their head will all be about progressing how they can make a lot of functional stuff happen. Mostly it's not about what's really required by a user, that is. Okay, so there's a few different things, a few different methods for doing this, but one of the ones I like most is actually from how we do stuff in web design. Okay, so this is part of the web design manual. And we've got here awareness, understanding, and action, and it's in a nice little circle. Okay? So we can see that we've got some kind of purpose here. What we're doing. We've got choices that we need to make based on user satisfaction, so these choices that we'll make, you know what we're going to do. And then we've got some action, we're going to do something, and that action goes into a system. Okay? And then we've got some awareness from the users. Some awareness of whether this is working, whether it's not working. Some awareness of whether of what's required or isn't required based on whether this is the first time you've gone down this loop or whether this is iterative. Okay? And then you've got some understanding about what we need to do next, which gives you purpose to do something. Yeah? So here we can see that we've got information coming in, because we need some way to understand how we're going to do stuff and what is required. That gives us purpose, but also we've got information going out. So once we think this is we've gone around this circle enough times, it's actually this way, obviously, enough times, then we get some information outcome. We get something that we can spit out. Okay? So this loop, awareness, understanding and action is really important because it allows you to kind of think or apply it to whatever you're doing. So first of all, when you're doing some software development, or indeed you're trying to get some materials together to start, do you have an awareness of what's required? Do you have an awareness of how this should go forward? If you've got an awareness of what people want, of what you're trying to do you have some understanding? Okay, what is it they really want? How are you going to really do it? And does that understanding give you enough to create action, to do something really? Okay. So these things you should be thinking about. And so while this is a semi-complicated, well, it's not complicated, it's just a kind of loop diagram thing. But the reality is that just remembering this, AUA, awareness, understanding, action. Okay? That's something that you should take with you so you can kind of apply that to most of the techniques that are coming up. Okay, and here from the same one is another set, design, discover, design and use. And this is part of the design process that a lot of, so in web design, how many people have done web application development, web design? Okay, good. And when I say, so quite a few of you actually good, and when I say web design, what do I mean by design? What do you mean by design? So what do you mean by design? Yes, you said you did some. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by design?
Well,
What kind of design are you thinking you're doing, or are you doing, when you're doing it? You don't know. Okay. Yes.
Probably often designers think of how the thing looks like the colors, etc. Whereas you're probably talking about construction design, but what the flows are like, how the user can get from one thing to another.
Okay. So that's good, but is that what you guys do? Are you thinking, when I say design, flow design, interaction design, or are you thinking, right, bang out the functionality? What is it? What I've been asked to create this functionality, and this is what I'm going to now design. Are you designing functionality, or are you designing experience? Yeah.
Mainly like experience, like user flows from one point to another, and what they're trying to achieve.
Okay, so that's what you're doing. So when you do it yourself, that's what you do. Or that's what you should
do. Important, not.
Yeah, no, I'm saying, but you know, you all go put your hand up, you've done some web stuff, design, development, but the kind of web design that you've done, I'm wondering, is that interaction design, experience design, is it more about functionality? Is it more about, yeah?
I'd say, predominantly, you are thinking of how what you're trying to build is going to work, so you are designing functionally, but at the same time, you're not trying to make a hash of it, you want to make it, like, I would try and make it nice to use, whether that's specifically experience design.
Okay, nice to use, yeah, okay.
So it's more like maybe a secondary objective to make it look nice and pretty usable.
Okay, secondary objective to make it look nice.
Finding out the functionality of it.
Finding out the functionality is the first thing. Anybody else? Yeah?
It depends what you're building. If you use something that's got a lot of users using it, you need usability, you need to focus on usability on it.
Yeah.
It's not just about what you make.
I hope you're right. I would say that looking at a lot of the tools out there, you're probably not right, but I hope you're right, because there's lots of people using tools that are just bagger spanners. Okay? Okay. So, in this case, discover, design, and use. This is really coming from design. Okay? From the design process for actual people who think of themselves as designers, graphic designers, product designers. Okay, not somebody who, interaction designers say, not somebody who considers herself a software engineer and is going to design the software. Okay, so what these guys are looking at is this discover, design and use. So they want to discover what's happening, what the user wants, what's happening in the user space. They want to do some design so that they can kind of understand that better, and then they want to get some understanding of use. Okay, you can see this kind of loop in the middle, which talks about explore, that exploration gives you choices. The choices lead you to a design, some design choices too. You get to evaluate it and see how it matches against objectives. Okay, these things, I mean, this isn't rocket science, right? It's very simple. It's kind of easy to understand, straightforward and obvious. Am I right? Is it obvious? Or are you all going, wow, I'm so completely blown away? I hope that's not what you're thinking. Yeah? Just come straight, yeah?
I think things like this, I think everyone does innately, through common sense, but maybe not in this structured format like here.
Yeah, I think people do try and do it, and I think that you're right, but by not having a structure to hang it off, sometimes you miss a step, sometimes you forget a step, sometimes common sense isn't quite so common. Sorry, but I hate the word common sense, I hate that phrase. Common sense got us into so much trouble. Science, that's what we want. Okay? Common sense, God. You see some of the people out there. Okay. So, we can see that there's this idea that we want to discover, design, and use. You've got to make sure, because the designers do, people when they're designing the iPod, etc. They're not thinking to themselves, oh well, what do users want and we'll do exactly what they want. They're bringing their expertise to it, they're bringing their specialism to it, they're bringing their training to it. Of course they must do. Same as you do. You must do. Okay? But we've also got to base this in what's called user-centered design. Yeah? So, in the old days, actually we'll go back one. What happened in the old days for designing software 10, 15, 20 years ago? I know sometimes before some of you were born, you were people, but go on.
Waterfall type thing?
Common?
Like waterfall type?
Waterfall models, yeah. So we have waterfall models, and at the end of the waterfall model, I mean, in that waterfall model, is there anything about user evaluation or what happens when it all goes pear-shaped? Not much. Okay, anything else? No? Yeah?
A lot of testing was done at the end.
It wasn't very iterative, so we've got that cycle going on in case we can catch errors. Okay, when people were building systems, how much did they consult users, do you think? Nothing. Okay, so you had it.
I was just going to say, just at the beginning when they gather requirements and then it freezes and then they carry out and meet the requirements.
Right, so that's right. So in that phase, the requirements gathering phase, you get the requirements elicitation and analysis, and then it often stops. And then you get to form the specification with your functional and non-functional requirements. You're looking at for your nouns and these kind of sentence or paragraph structures coming back from the users. Then, as long as you meet the specification, you're supposedly okay. So why do we have feature creep? You know what feature creep is, right? Yeah? So, I mean, generally, I would have thought that as soon as you meet the exact specification, you're done, right, as a software engineer in this process, but that often isn't the case. Why not?
Because users discover stuff that they didn't actually think of before.
Yes, because users discover stuff they didn't think of before, and also because... Yeah, what are you going to say? Yeah, because the specification's wrong. The users don't tell you everything. Well, what they do tell you might not be correct. There might be reasons for them. Okay, to not tell you things. So who watches the House TV show? How? Who's heard of House? It's like a weird doctor dude who's, Hugh Laurie, that's right. Yeah. Okay, so he has a phrase in there which says, everybody lies. That's a good phrase to think of when you're doing user experience. No, they don't necessarily lie, but they might be selective with the truth, or they might just forget, or not care. What you've got to also realise is that users probably don't see the benefit. If you're in the company and you're trying to build new systems, the users just think, you're getting on my nerves, you're getting in my way. Leave me alone. I've got work to do. Okay? Oh yes, I'll answer all these questions for you, that'll take me 6 hours. So that's something that you also need to factor in. So of course, this is an evolving process. So trying to write a specification at the start, or just after the requirements analysis has occurred, is often a problem. And that's how it used to be done. Now, user-centered design was created, all participatory design. So we're all interested about what people want, okay? Now this is the message that you're gonna get from designers and sort of more psychology-based or sociology-based user experience people. This isn't, of course, completely true. What people want might not be what they ought to have, okay? And that's where you need to factor in your experience, that's where you need to factor in your skill and your understanding of the whole area, what's possible and what isn't possible, okay? You can see this as well with lots of design. So if you've got lots of graphic design, for instance, it's very difficult, oftentimes, to be able to let a graphic designer know that what they've designed isn't technically feasible. Okay? Very difficult conversation. Because designers are artists normally, and those artists, and because they're artists, they think that their design is art. And you can't mess with that. You're messing with them then. That's part of who they are. Okay, so it's a very difficult conversation you're going to have. But user-centered design is one of the most important parts of user experience. But it's got to be proportionate, okay? Okay, so we're going to have some standard terminology, the standard who, what, where, kind of thing, and when, etc. And how all our methods work. So the first thing is who. Who does this stuff? So we've got actors, refers to a specific instance of users, such as a customer, a manager, salesforce. So we've got an actor. Who else might we have? Who has got their sticky little fingers on a piece of software? Or at least a specification for a piece of software that you're going to have to either tell them they're wrong about or kind of ratify.
Application owner, yeah, okay.
Stakeholder, okay. I think we've got stakeholders, in fact, but in this case they're less involved. Any more? Okay. So we've got people who just have this general role idea. So describes the persona that the user will be taking, such as the purchaser or the seller. So in some of these cases, we don't know who, we can't actually get to the user immediately. So we have to kind of fake it a bit. And a proxy, okay? You describe a person who's not a specific user, but claim the role in case of proxy sales plot. So they're not even a user there. They're not even one of these role persons, not even a purchaser or seller. They're just somebody who's pretending. Now, this is interesting, this proxy and this role concept. Why is it interesting? It's interesting in user experience because a lot of the time you will, or you might, use techniques which are used semi-frequently, becoming more popular, whereby you employ actors. So you employ actors to take on the role of these people in certain situations. And those actors then act out a scene such that the software engineers who are sitting here can kind of understand better what the problems are. Now I do this a lot for older users, where you've got sort of actors pretending to be very old users and looking at the, and taking on a persona of characterization of that user. Okay? And the only reason why this happens is so that it gives you guys, or software engineers, technical people, more of an inside view of what it's really like. It's far more useful than just reading something on a bit of paper. Okay? Okay, now, what? What is it now that we're going to require? Now, I'm not going to take 5 minutes, but the first bit is the current system. So we want an understanding of the current system. You guys now have got 5 minutes, so I want you to get into little groups or friends or turn around and meet new people you never thought you'd meet before. And you've got 5 minutes till 12:34 to come up with another three. One is fine actually, but let's see if you can come up with another three things that you would need to start making some kind of headway into the design process. Okay? So that involves you actually not next year we'll do
anything. I didn't work really wake up until that actually. This one
budgeting.
Out. Okay, so Wikipedia, thank you. Okay, Moscow, we might use. Okay. Okay. Okay, anything else? Any other stuff? Yes?
How long have you got to develop?
How long you got to develop? Yeah, that's good.
The methodology that I would use, XP or Scrum.
Okay, methodology, XP, Scrum, that kind of thing, yeah. A lot of this is quite functional though, I'm noticing, because you're software engineers, that's how you're thinking, so, yeah.
If the user is the users are familiar with a certain type of programs that we might need to follow, let's say that...
Yeah, familiarity, that's a key part of the kind of programs. In fact, that's why we have sort of standard look and feel and standard design guidelines for operating systems, so that you can try and get some of that familiarity across. Okay, I'm going to take one more, then I'm going to take, then I'm going to pick on some people who I noticed when I was wandering around before. Well, what did you be talking? Okay, to each other.
Scope, what's in your scope and what's not.
Okay, what's in the scope, what's not, yeah, that's true. Okay, so the back row, you three guys at the back. I was looking previously at you guys and you were just sitting there in passive. Come on, so tell me something. They said everything you thought about.
What are the user stories?
What are the user stories? What are the user stories? What are they doing? Yeah, what kind of, what are their backgrounds? Okay, cool. You three, I notice are you as well, chair of CS Society. Come on! It might have been a terrible night out last night, but come on! Who knows?
The thing that's too far down the line, I was thinking by any special needs of users in these particular needs to kind of depend on the system.
Very good, special needs of users. Yeah? And what kind of things might special needs of users be if we get away from kind of disability maybe? What other kinds of special needs? What could we think of special needs?
Anything to do with your memory, you want to have something that you need on screen, you don't want to have to be flicking back and forth.
Yeah.
Anything
to aid the memory, you don't want to be flicking back and forth, good. There's also other kinds of stuff where we might think, are there going to be language problems? So, you know, is it people who are English or whatever language you're building this in is going to be a second language, that kind of thing. Okay, any more? Who else didn't? Oh, yes.
There's context as well. So if it's going to be something that people just need information quickly, then sort of design more like, if it's something you sort of experience a bit more, you spend a bit more time with it, it can design a bit more.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah.
If there's any kind of laws that you need to apply by, so data protection?
Laws, data protection, that kind of thing? Yeah.
Cultural kind of issues as well.
Pardon?
So, cultural kind of
issues. Cultural, yeah.
So, depending on the country, they might have to call it all the milk, like Chinese would like red, black, and white or something.
Yeah. In fact, that's very interesting. One thing at the very early outset of the web was that. In Japan, people didn't normally click on links because blue's an unlucky colour. So that's a cultural thing that people didn't understand, and it's got to be taken into account. Yeah.
Maybe the cryptographer doesn't want the code to go out or somebody who steals the programs.
Okay, so the project owner might not want the code to be going out, so you've got sort of kind of open access issues. Okay, yeah, well, this would be fine.
Could you ask them how they're feeling about the change, or how their team's feeling about the change, whether they're going to be receptive to it or not too keen on this change? Or...
Okay, so yeah, what's the people's understanding of the change itself? So this is very interesting for work where you might be, you know, if you're working in a consultancy, and you're going down into that. You're going into a company whereby they're worried that computerisation might reduce their job specification. It might see some people unemployed. They're far more likely to be hesitant, and they're far more likely to be negative about your system because perception is of key importance even before the system has been created. Okay, that's the final. This is the final.
Make a system easily distinguishable from other systems that might be being used at the same time. So
okay, so yeah, make it easily distinguishable. But how do you get over the familiarity aspect? You need familiar and distinguishable, so it's kind of a difficult one to go for. Those are all good. In fact, there's so many I've been writing down, but I decided not to, because I think we're pretty good just doing it freeform. So the ones I've got are current documentation. So you can understand a lot from what current documentation is out there, what kind of information already exists. Okay. So there's normally some standards, some specifications. Somebody's written something on how to do a particular task. If it's on a computer, or even if it's on some other computer, so even if it's manual. So for your original thought exercise, you've all been on the visit day, haven't you, when you first came 4 years ago, all that time ago. You've never been on a visit day. Gosh, well, you missed a treat then if you've not been on a visit day. Anyway, down in the corridor down there, there's a little museum thing with the Atlas machine and all the other bits and pieces. How could you relate it for your original thought, something to do with the Atlas machine, to this current documentation? Idea. But if you go down to look at the Atlas console, I suggest you do, you'll see that because it was completely taken from use the day it was left, the day that people stopped using it, it's full of sticky notes. There's lots of documentation stuck to it. Bits of paper with do this for this, you know, little sums on it so that you can see what you're supposed to be pressing to get certain things to happen. That is a kind of a annotated documentation of the actual of how to use the system, because the actual manuals themselves weren't good enough. Okay, so people just said, oh, that's what happened, so I'm going to write a note about that and place it on the console. Okay, so that kind of thing, if you're going to create something new, you need to think about. Okay, improvements. What improvements could be made? Okay, so what kind of improvements could be made? And this is something that you guys would need to probably think about as computer scientists. What kind of improvements there are, because most of the people will be able to tell you what improvements might be made from their experience. Context was something that somebody down here, I think, talked about. So context is, context is useful. Okay, so that's also very useful as well here for the improvements, because they'll be talking about the improvements they see to their jobs, but you might be talking about other kinds of improvements that they don't know because they don't know they're possible. Newness, what changes, additions, subtractions are required? So in some cases, functionality might not be used in the current system. Okay, so there might be a whole stack of printed, where I used to work at the British Club, every day when I used to be at the British Club. And they used to be, you have stacks of these kind of triplicate forms in triplicate that nobody ever used. Yet, people who came in to actually build the systems still tried to computerise these triplicate forms that they never used. Okay. Why would the computer people try to computerise the forms even though they know that they weren't used? Well, there's two reasons. I know the real reason, but let's pretend I don't. Oh, okay. Yeah.
It's easy to do. The structure, you can just like follow the structure and like.
Yeah. It's easy to do the structure. That's one thing. Yeah.
But they could try to see why people didn't use it by looking at them.
Okay. They could try to see why people didn't use it. Yeah.
So that they don't.
Maybe not so. Yeah.
So that they don't get lost.
So they don't get lost. Okay. Sorry.
So if it was there in the first place, and then the new version is not, people might be able.
Yeah.
So they can charge
you
more for
exactly right. That's exactly why they did it. Consultants, £500 a day back then. Okay? So more days coding and more money. Simple. That's why they wanted to do it. You know, whether that's really the case is a whole other thing, but that is in the end why they wanted to do it. Okay, importance. What's important? So we can see that obviously this is kind of back to the Moscow thing. Okay? Must be implemented. Okay? Any more? Yeah?
Won't be.
That's right, yeah. Okay, so that kind of goes, that speaks to their own importance. You must also have a plan for design, agile participatory development, and handling feature creep. So these are the things you also need a plan for. Yeah. Okay, so feature creep is where you've created your system and you say, this is exactly what you said at the outset, and through these iterative stages, this has happened. And then the next iteration, somebody says, I could do with that feature. I could do with that feature. And suddenly, the features that you've costed start to creep until it's a whole other system that you're not being paid for anymore. Okay? So that's what you need to try and handle. What are you going to do when those features start to creep? Because there's got to be a point, even in iterative development, even in agile development, there's got to be a point when it all finishes. Okay? Even in cowboy coding. Who knows about cowboy coding? Okay? Just do what you like. Cowboy coding. Okay, so how is it done? How are we going to get the job done? So, observation. We observe stuff. We observe what's happening in the real world, okay? And then we kind of make notes about it. In fact, strangely enough, there are books and books and books about how to take notes. How to take notes, why they're important, what kind of notes should you take, when should you take notes. Anthropology is full of books about taking notes and how to do it. Something, you know, there's lots of different techniques. You might be observing people and then just go to the bathroom every 30 minutes, say you've got a weak bladder and write your notes up. Because if you write it in front of people, they'll freak out. Okay? Ultimately, you might do it at the end of the day, you might do it at your lunchtime. But whatever happens, there's plenty of ways to observe people and to take notes from a distance or up personally. Yeah? Analyse. So, we're going to look at different analysis techniques later on, but one of the analysis techniques is something called coding. When you're taking written notes, for instance, then you've got this idea called coding whereby all you do, as you've heard before, is categorise when, well, categorise really the frequency that concepts come up in the narrative, in your notes. You can then see how important it is to multiple participants. Yeah? And then we've got discussion. So this is often missed. So when we do requirements analysis and elicitation, there's very little discussion with users or discussion about anything. Okay? So discussion is key. Actually talking to people is key. Oftentimes, this is because, and it's changing now, I hope, but it used to be that software engineers aren't the most social, shall we say, people. Okay? So that can be a problem. Yeah? So we have to think to ourselves, are these the best people to be interfacing to users? Okay, if you're already in the code base, it's probably not. Okay, it's probably you guys, people who train in UX. Okay. So, we have different kinds of input. So here's a screenshot of a nice tool that's called Envivo, and this is the sort of tool that you'd be using if you were doing, well, it's called QOL, qualitative work or QOL. So when you get these, when some of the people come in who are employers, they'll be talking about qual, and this is what it is, qualitative work. They won't be talking about qualitative all the time, because it's too long work. So qual. And here we've got this Envivo system whereby you can use lots of stuff in it. So you can, here you can see that you've got some descriptions based on time. You've got some quotes, part of an interview process or a focus group process, and you can see that somebody's highlighted a concept here. And that concept, the more, and they'll give it a category, give it a name, and then they'll file more concepts as they read through this into those categories such that they can understand it. They can get some kind of metric from it. So why was this thought of it? I've told you this before, so hopefully you'll know it. Why is this kind of coding aspect in qualitative data important for, say, anthropology or social science, and us, but mainly them? Why was it important? So what's the kind of big difference between, say, psychology and sociology? Psychology and, say, sociology or anthropology. Let's say psychology and anthropology, in the way they do their science, the way they do their work. Why is it important for us? The first thing is what? Okay, so I'll tell you the difference. The first difference is that in psychology, it's laboratory based. Okay? It's very much based in the laboratory. And what do we measure in the laboratory?
Results, quantitative.
Quantitative results. We're trying to get quantitative stuff out of it, right? So that's what we're trying to do, and that's what other psychology is. They control for what kind of factors?
Confounding variables.
Okay? So that means that it's not real world, because they're trying to find out a specific thing about a specific thing, okay, with nothing that can affect it. Why is that different to anthropology? And of course they're using statistical analysis to analyse everything, so why is that different to anthropology? What happens in anthropology?
It's mainly observing,
yeah, but is it observing lots and lots of people, or mostly a small amount? Pardon? Small groups or individuals, okay? And they're observing and then they're writing stuff down. And what does the writing stuff mean? Are they measuring anything? They're not. Because that's not what they're trying to get. They're trying to get a flavour of a more rich description. So the thing with psychology is you don't get a very rich description, but it's quite precise. The thing with anthropology is you get a very rich description, but it's maybe not that precise. or even applicable. And we see that coming together in, who's representing the automated cycle maintenance? Ah, yes. Do we see that coming together in Zen and the automated cycle maintenance?
Yeah.
Good, that's the right answer. Okay, this kind of tension between the two. And user experience is exactly that. We have this tension between the two, as I've been saying. Okay, so this is why. So why do we think then that anthropology decided to have this coding deal? Yeah?
To try and turn their data into something that they could almost quantify.
Yeah, that's right. They, you know, there's kind of this idea that, or there was this idea that we're going to do this so we can kind of quantify what's there, so we can put some numbers on it. Okay? So we can make it more precise and less less descriptive, less rich, I think. But then there was a bit of a backlash against that, and you get a term called reductionism. Has anybody heard of it? So by reducing things to something like physics, say, to the world as particles, we lose something about the richness of the world. Okay, how they interact together, etc. Same is true with a lot of people think that by reducing this to categorization and trying to get something more specific, more quantifiable, we are reducing it. We are taking out the richness. We're not able to then see the get a flavour of what the reality is. Okay, so that's something that you'll have to deal with because everybody else does. Okay, that's just what we have to think about. Okay, so I noticed that I'm thinking a lot longer than I imagined. But we'll go forward. 6 months. So if you've got 6 months, then we've got something called participant observation. Okay? So if you've got a long period of time to do stuff, then you can do stuff like participant observation, which means that you rock up into a scenario and you then decide that you're going to be the, you're going to just do the work and integrate into the community of the people you're observing. Okay? Sometimes you might be part of that community, but you might have another specialism. You wouldn't be a keen informant, okay? But you'd be a participant practitioner probably. Okay, so you'd be doing your kind of coding work, but you'd also be part of that community too, so you kind of know that community better. That's the idea of this. So it's learning by doing. That's what you're in there for. It's long term. So I've got 6 months because that's kind of what we can get our head around. But any anthropologist would think anything less than 2 or 3 years is just pivotal. Okay, if you can't write a 400-page monologue out of it, then it's rubbish. Okay. So that's what you're trying to get to. So 6 months, to them, they think, oh, that's far too short. But we just, in HCI, we're lucky to get 6 months. Okay? It's embedded and embedded. So you're embedded in the group, and you're also trying to be invisible to that group. Okay? So there's lots of interesting ways of doing this, and a lot of this stuff was, that was it, where was a lot of this stuff? There's two places that were key for anthropology in this kind of the way that some of these techniques happen. Where was the major place? Anybody know? University of Chicago. Okay? So University of Chicago was a major place, and they did a lot of work on what was called then deviancy. Okay, in the 30s. So anything that wasn't normal, if you like, what they considered to be normal. So if you believed in not Jesus, then you obviously deviant. And so that kind of thing. Yeah? Previously, which is the wrong thing to do, but previously there was a certain type of anthropologist called a veranda anthropologist. Why were they called that, do you think? Your observation points. Because it was the 1850s, and they rocked up to some, you know, hot location, and you know, in the Congo or whatever, sat on the veranda of their bungalow and just called the people into them and said, oh, tell me something about your life. Okay, that was it. It was really disparaging. Okay? And that's not how we do it now, so that's the plan. You need to be embedded. And you need to be in some ways invisible. Copious notes. lots of notes, lots of analysis. You see that these ethnographies can go on. Of an individual, ethnographies can go on for 400, 500 pages about what they do, why they do it, how they do it, to try and find out more about stuff. And all this has been really useful. Certainly been useful in terms of drug abuse in the 1950s and 60s in lots of different American cities. There's been lots of interesting... it formed the basis for a lot of health projects to try and reduce drug abuse in cities in the 50s and 60s. So even the level of rich data allows you to connect better with an individual as opposed to just lots of stats. Okay. Conversations with a purpose. So this is where you don't have an interview sheet set up, you don't have a set of questions, but you have sort of an idea of where you're trying to get the participant to go to. Okay, and then you just talk to them, and it looks like a conversation, but really you're directing it in the background because you want to investigate something that you've seen occur as part of the observation. So you might rock up to, you might be there in having coffee with some of your colleagues who you're embedded with, and you might have seen some behaviour occurring, and so therefore, in the, you know, for the system you're going to build, and so therefore you might sort of say, oh, you know, did you have a good night last night? Yes, it was great, blah, 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 all that stuff. And they say, oh, well, I saw you doing this earlier on. What was that about? So you, and then they just have a conversation. You don't just sit down with your diary or your notepad or your kind of clipboard in a room. You know, here's the questions I've already got formulated. Why don't we have now normally a set of questions that you've already got formulated in your head in this way? What does that add?
It was pressure.
Pressure? Yeah, anything else? What does it make of the silence?
It goes down a certain direction.
Certain direction, and that direction is led by the investigator, and that means that there's a bias there. So any questionnaire means that there's a bias there, because somebody's thought of the questions. Okay, they're not emergent. Yeah? Okay. Deep but narrow. So in this case, it's very narrow to specific people or groups and populations, but it's very deep. So if you're building a bespoke ordering system, sales system, or something else for a group of people, for a company, then you might need to go deep. You don't need it to be generalizable to every company, just this one. But if you're trying to make an app that's good for everybody, that's a whole different deal. Okay. Strategy is to not stand out. So when you're in this kind of 6-month participant observation situation, the idea is that you just integrate. You don't stand out, you don't do anything different to everybody else, you will have a job to do, but you just might do it very badly. Okay? Because that's not what your focus is really. Okay. We've got another system, task analysis. Learning by observing. Okay, so instead of learning by doing, you are actually there looking at what you're really observing the people. It can be short term, so it doesn't have to be this 6 months, but it's not as long term. It's still invisible. But it can be remote, so you can be looking at people remotely through video cameras, that kind of thing, in what they're up to. Okay? It can be close, it can be discursive as well, but you're always bothered about task analysis, and so the participant observation is more kind of emergent. Task analysis is more top-down, because you've already got some ideas about what the tasks are. Okay. How can these tasks apply? We're not going to take 5 minutes, because I'm running too late. So, if we've got 6 weeks, then we've got focus groups and interviews. So we learn by asking. So all we're doing here is we're asking participants, and sometimes we'll do it in the focus group, and sometimes we'll do it by asking one-to-one interviews, but hopefully we'll do all these things in combination. So what's the problem with learning by asking? Yeah?
People want to give model answers, which might not want to give truthful answers.
Yeah, people want to give model answers, which might not be the truthful answers. So it's not how do you do it, it's how you should do it. They might know how they should do it, they just might not do it like that because of the same reason. But they'll tell you how they should do it because that's what they have to tell their bosses. Yeah? What else by asking?
Well, how do you know what questions to ask? What are
Yeah, how do you know what questions to ask? So normally you've been probably primed by their stakeholders who have a certain outcome they want, but might not be these users might not be those stakeholders, they might not have that certain outcome. So yeah, that's the problem. Yeah?
Some people differ in how they articulate their thoughts.
Yeah, some people will differ in how, you know, will have a problem with how they articulate their thoughts. Yeah, that's very true. And so you have to interpret that. That can be a problem. Also, what does House say?
Everybody lies.
Everybody lies. Okay. So they either lie or they just get it wrong, or they don't do it quite right, or they... What else do they do? What else do people do? If you're describing something, do you go into every single tiny detail of what you do? Or do you skip stuff? Because it's obvious or boring. So that's what these guys do. When you ask the questions, they skip stuff. Okay? Alright. So, but it's a lot faster. Okay? So, it's very much faster than the six-month break. But there's a hidden thing. Groupthink. So what's groupthink? So when you've got a focus group, what's groupthink?
Is it where other people are influenced by what someone else has said already?
Yeah.
To change their answer.
That's right. It's where other people are influenced by maybe what a strong participant in that group thinks. And so the whole group starts to think like that one person. Okay. So you can see that how in trials, jury-based trials, they're not particularly perfect, because you might have one strong juror who influences the rest of the people. So therefore, you've got this groupthink, which is not an individual thing. It's one person leading a group. Okay. It's wide, so you can get lots of answers to lots of questions, but it's very shallow because somebody's created the questions. Yeah. Semi-structured, so that's another problem. You're not letting the questions emerge. It's semi-structured and requires even less interpretation, so that's why lots of people do it. It takes a lot of time to go through copious notes created in an ethnography. Loads of time. But for this, not so much, because, you know, you've got these questions. In fact, in some ways, get them to do it online, click a few boxes, you can even work out stats for you. Great stuff. Okay?
And that way you do it anonymously as well, so people are more likely to be truthful in what they say.
That's true. So on a questionnaire-based approach, if it's online, you can do it anonymously. If it's face-to-face, it's far more difficult. Yeah. So there are benefits, of course. I mean, I think that the whole point of this is that you use the techniques that you are able to use in the real world. So if you've only got 6 weeks, well, unfortunately, but you have no choice but to use this, because you can't do observation. Maybe a bit. You just have to decide what resources you've got, what time you've got, how it all fits together. We'll look at that in real life. Okay, so we've got a chapter on real life, and it tells you the problems that happen. And the BBC will be talking to you about the problems they have in real world stuff, based on both on what their managers think as well as what users think. Okay, social. So you can shorten the 6 months. So the social is nothing drastic. All that it means is, again, it's a bit like conversations with a purpose, but you just take people to a pub, mainly, or give them some cake, give them some tea, have a chat, see what comes back. Okay, quite quick to do, you're just talking. You can't get a full picture, but it's far more relaxed, and it's also just really very social. And then you might have somebody taking notes away. So they can see what's happening, they know what's going on, but they can take these notes themselves, so that you don't have to. You can just be concentrating on asking the questions, directing the answers. Or directing where they're going. Yeah. So that can be a lot faster. Another one, if you don't have many users, or very few users, what do you do? Well, archival analysis. So archival analysis was used in the old days of anthropology and social science, and it still is today a lot. We can use mailing lists. So for instance, if you want to understand problems that people have had using systems, or what systems they use, why don't you look at the mailing list, do an archival analysis of all the mailing lists, because people are normally landing on there. Okay, so you can actually find out what the problems are without asking anybody, because it's not biased then. They just said, I'm having a problem with this, how can I fix it? Okay, or I like these features, how can I get them? Okay, so we've done that lots of times with lots of different mailing lists. But it all comes from understanding or analysing sort of, well, maybe documents that are used in the workplace, currently used in the workplace, communication methods that are currently used in the workplace, and that kind of thing. Okay. Ah, finally. 10 minutes, so back at 20 past. I know the day is getting shorter, we're going to have a quick run into the second part. Okay. Alright, so come back at... come back at 7:15. Not 20 past, 7:15, according to this clock. I'm going to go to the school and I'm going to go to the school. So that's why we pushed to get this third year course, but there's not, I mean, the first year is a really big
high. It's all of you eventually, though, isn't it?
Then you feel bad.
Now, bizarre, in the conversation, so we might be
we left off 18 minutes to you, so we went to South Bond away.
And even then, if you have a million, even then, you can end up. That's what we're on the way.
to, and maybe even add functionality to process on the back. So not everything is to do with computerisation. Oftentimes you'll find that post-it notes and these little cards and scraps of paper are really useful things to sort of start to get some formative ideas. Why?